A qualitative summary of student-created video projects, a strategy to encourage assignment completion and originality. Presenter, Dane C. Sorensen. Education Class 6777, Section 213, Using Data to Improve Student Learning. Professor Sarah Bryans-Bongey, College of St. Scholastica, Duluth, Minnesota, May 11, 2013. In Carl Sagan's seminal work, The Demon-Haunted World, he writes in 1996, "The problems in public education, in science and other subjects, run so deep that it is easy to despair and conclude they can never be fixed. Truer words were never spoken, and unfortunately not fully understood by the public and in many cases not by the educational establishment of this country. When I graduated from St. Scholastica and moved down south to teach English language arts, I thought I was well prepared for whatever challenges would face me. However, the reality was that my education in education was just beginning. When I prepare for going to work, I often wonder how the day will go. I think of the challenges and obstacles that need to be faced. Coming from a world where education was valued, to a school dominated by generational poverty and a student population that was over 94% African American, I found myself quickly frustrated and on many days filled with anger at the very students I was charged with educating. This was the beginning of a trek of personal and professional growth that continues today. Many of the ideas I will share in the short film came about in what I now realize was an informal and by the seat of my pants research project. The two classes on action research that I have taken in the last 8 months have allowed me to formalize and verify my ideas to improve education for my students." As mentioned before, it was the issue of academic dishonesty, or as we call it on the street, cheating, that bothered me. Also reflected in the low SAT scores of my school, it was evidently obvious that the rigor of learning was low. All the educational issues that predominantly black schools face have been documented in probably thousands of studies. The same goes for schools dominated by generational poverty. There were two books that really helped me understand the culture of a school like mine, where 94% of the school is African American, and a huge amount are on free or reduced lunch. The first was Dr. Ruby Payne's book, A Framework for Understanding Poverty. In her book, she describes the hidden rules of the poor, the middle class, and the rich. Most revealing were the rules of poverty when related to education. There are two rules that struck me as surreal. The first was that if you come into some unexpected money, you are expected to either share it or spend it as quickly as you can. Poverty is all about helping each other to survive. So extra money, food, or in the case of education, answers are all expected to be shared. To not share is considered rude and selfish. I did an anonymous poll with my ELA students last month, and they confirmed Payne's idea that it is rude to not share answers. I randomly picked an assignment that was a study guide on British poetry. The students were to complete the study guide as we worked on the poems in the class. Most did not bother to do so. As you can see in Table 4, the all-class average for copied study guides was 53% of those turned in. 29% of the students did not bother to turn in the study guides for credit. Surprisingly, the smartest kids in the class were the ones who copied each other's work the most, and they had the highest grades in the test for British poetry. Those who did the work on the study guide themselves had the second highest scores on the test that followed on the unit of British poetry. The 29% who did not bother to turn in the study guide had the lowest test grade on the unit, as well as the lowest overall grades for the year. In an anonymous poll given to the students, 62 out of 66 students admitted to helping someone cheat in a test. As seen in Table 1, the top method of cheating is whispering the answer. Tied at 21% is giving a note with the answers or letting someone see the answers on the test. An up-and-coming method used by 8% was taking a photo of the test with a smartphone and sending it to others. Most of my tests are multiple choice, and so it is hard to track cheating, whereas study guides, it was easy to match the handwritten answers. The second rule of poverty that Payne wrote about concerned the lack of rigor by the students in their studies. My school's SAT scores rank in the low 30th percentile, too low to get into a good four-year college. The rule that impacts this is the notion that you can't get ahead, which is based on the belief in fate. Choice is a middle-class notion, whereas often the poor feel that they have no choices in life. This leads to polarized thinking. Many students of generational poverty often react by saying, "I can't do this," when faced with a task that requires prolonged effort. This also reflects the poor not having long-term goals. Thus, I see a large amount of students shut down and not complete their homework because they feel the assignment is pointless and or a difficult education task. A case in point is Table 6, which shows an all-class average for non-completion ranged from 31 to 41%, and plagiarism ran as high as 8% for a book review assignment. The students had to check out a British book, read it, and then write a book review. They had, on average, 8 weeks to do this assignment, and yet the overall average of not turning in the assignment was 36% and 5% for plagiarism. This is a good example of a poorly designed assignment for a school dominated by generational poverty and African Americans. A second book that helped me understand my students was Tom Burrell's book, Brainwashed, Challenging the Myth of Black Inferiority. Burrell writes about the baggage that many blacks suffer from that is keeping them down. As Burrell bravely asks, why are blacks always on the bottom of every good list and at the top of every bad list? Both Payne and Burrell talk about how blacks do not truly value education. Any black student who tries to excel is often accused of being white and is shunned. One of my more perceptive black students calls this the crab in the bucket syndrome. When one crab tries to crawl out of the bucket, other crabs will reach up and try and pull him back down to their level. Burrell has a chapter called D's Will Do, where he writes about how many blacks will settle for the lowest passing grade. I have been asked many times by a black student if they will still get a D if they don't turn in an assignment. Understanding this rejection of education by so many blacks made me realize why so many of my students did not do the book reviews. One final thought about sharing answers. As I discovered, it was the smartest kids who participated in this behavior. Perhaps there was more than cheating going on here. Do they copy the smartest kids' answers, or do they crowdsource bits and pieces? What is the motivation of the smart kids to share answers? Is it the rules of poverty on sharing resources, or just the brightest ensuring they get the best grade at whatever cost? By the brightest blacks sharing answers, is this their way of avoiding being accused of being too smart, of trying to crawl out of the bucket? Changing these behaviors of academic dishonesty or of non-completion would be a monumental task, especially since I get these students in their last year in high school. Also, attacking these behaviors would mean I would have to confront hundreds of years of discrimination, plus fight the rules of both poverty and to fight the black cultural rules found in a poor southern community. Burrell states that blacks were oppressed for so long that they have taken over their own brainwashing to settle for being second rate. Burrell quotes President Obama, who lamented in a speech to the NAACP, quote, "We need a new mindset, a new set of attitudes, because one of the most durable and destructive legacies of discrimination is the way we have internalized a sense of limitation, how so many of our community have come to expect so little of ourselves." That, in a nutshell, is my dilemma. How to stop cheating and non-completion of assignments that is being fueled by the issues of poverty and race. Strict enforcement of middle-class educational expectations would result in high failure rates, which in my school would bring serious charges of failure to teach. The hidden rules of education at my school are that you must not let rigor cause widespread failure. Be that as it may, I have chosen a profession with one thing in mind, and that is to teach and help the students, in spite of the inequities, bureaucracy, taboos, and wallpaper. Within those constraints, I sought to design new assignments that would avoid cheating and non-completion, and, most importantly, not give in to mindless assignments that offer no critical thinking skills or personal growth. This is what led me to my incorporating video technology into student assignments. I first tried this in March 2012 in my classroom. In a literature review on student-made video assignments, it was found that most were composed of the following steps: pre-production, production, post-production, and finally public screening. In pre-production, students are taught about the background of this, I believe, radio broadcast, and then given instructions as to how they are to create an updated technological version in the form of a video. The students were given a handout which had a list of suggested topics and also a detailed view of the assignment. During pre-production, students pick their topics and create their essay script, which included teacher review and editing. When those steps are finished, student teams helped each other video record the essays in the production stage. In post-production, each student edits his video down to a perfect take and includes additional graphics. For the public screening, a class period is devoted to showing everyone's final video. Another aspect that I added to the public screening section is compiling all the class videos into one DVD and giving each student a copy to keep as a high school memory of their thoughts and beliefs. In Table 8, we compare side by side the British Book Review and the British Poetry Study Guide with this, I believe, video assignment. As you can see, non-completion was dramatically lower in the video assignment, and plagiarism was virtually eliminated. To go from 41% of the class failing a book review assignment to only 16% failing the This I Believe video assignment is a 39% drop in failures. Removing assignments that are designed for failure by both African American students and generational poverty students would result in many more students passing this core subject. Students seem to be more engaged and motivated to express their beliefs, knowing that it ultimately would be shared with their cohort. The most common component that was not completed was the video recording. Most of the students who did not do the recording gave the reason that they hated to be in videos or do public speaking. Only two students who were part of the non-completion group failed to write their essays. With a unit like this, you can give grades for the various tasks such as essay drafting, editing the essay, video recording, and video editing. Multiple grading opportunities can limit the grading damage a student can experience. This, I believe, essay was done by a young man who jumped at the chance of using skills that are not necessarily prized by the educational establishment. But as you can see, if you had a chance to explore the words and structure, many of the poetic devices that we try and teach, alliteration, internal rhyme, etc., are very much evident in this unique work. In closing, before I show the video, I would like to thank Professor Sarah for all her encouragement to complete this course.
This I believe.
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 This I believe. I believe in my lyrics, cause success is what it will bring. Great people talk about ideas, average people talk about things. Small people talk about other people because they believe no one is equal. I believe after your life story is over, there's bound to be a sequel. Why is this? Nobody really understands it. The world is in too much controversy because we don't understand it. We just turn on television and devour knowledge, even though the government spits out information as coverage. But I don't believe in everything like failure. You should never believe in failure. No matter what they tell you, this might be a project, but I'm giving it more value. If you believe in success, then doing you what you love should hold value. But love is evil, spell it backwards, I'll show you. You don't have to let the evil consume you, because then it will rule you. Cause this is not a haiku. These lyrics I put my time into. Placing instrumental and I'm bound to spit a rhyme or two. I'm not Dr. Seuss, neither Naruto Pablo. Placing my pictures with someone higher like Edgar Allan Poe. My lyrics should paint you a picture like Da Vinci in the Renaissance era. I paint 10 times better. Decorate Mona Lisa with cover girl mascara. Call it graffiti, but ironically, this considered a crafty. Because I can turn a good thing into a catastrophe, so don't be mad at me if these minutes might roll over three. Cause to me it's like saying my ABCs, symbol and metaphors, along with a little bit of similes. No hesitation, I bring life to these words like personification. Isn't it good to have a little education? I doubt you would disagree, because along with education, I'm taking this whole assignment to a new degree. I might not go to Harvard, but I'm bound to make a greater pay, because even valedictorians of your school can make a lesser pay. You don't have to be a brainiac or even a teacher's pet. You can still make millions. This right here, I bet. So never forget who said it first, cause situations can get much worse. You're about to witness my brain burst. So you can hold your Porsches. If you can't hold your Porsches, sit back, relax, listen, and pray for a good fortune. Once again, I believe in my lyrics, because when I speak the truth, I'm just aiming for you viewers to fear it. Consider me a nightmare, but I don't reside on Elm Street. Even though I might be a little discreet, when I'm in my zone, I picture a sanitarium. In the future, you'll be watching me like great whites in aquariums. Nowadays, people listen to capers created by random people, but it works cause they're the ones making the paper. But I can write for days and have endless words for endless paper. But there is also a slim chance that I won't be able to make the paper. But I still believe, not that I can fly, but I believe that I can be that number one guy. From a prince to a king, I just wanna sit on the throne. I wanna be the top dog, the one with the biggest bone. So when I'm an elderly old man, I'll come rolling home in the Lamborghini, because life is too short. I'm not gonna waste it smoking on ports, ending up on life support. Because I'm different, like Chinese people cooking soul food. Feed off my lyrics, that's if you were eating soul food. I write as if this was a journal entry, but I don't write as much like certain females do inside diaries, writing about your dearest loved ones and saying they'll be together for eternity. If you believe in evil, then your love is full of it, surely. But rise above it, overcome all the obstacles, even if you think it's not possible. Because believe me, it is possible. We know talk is cheap, but we still pay the price to listen, even though we try to listen with our ears missing. So read between my lines and tell me if you understand me. If you don't, you'll never be in the same game as me. I'm on a different level, better yet, a different altitude. If you understand what I'm saying, please accept my gratitude. I'm not trying to claim that I am real, because we are so unreal. Yeah, I said it, we are so unreal. Don't get caught in the confusion, we are merely an illusion. We are another creation, just a figment of God's imagination. So you might not own a shovel, but I'm hope you're digging this. Like carpal tunnel in your hands, I'm really hope that you're feeling this. You'll be a true fan if you can make this poem recitable, because truly, it's not even rehearsable. I treat this with my passion, my lyrics are always personal. I can say words and phrases that can tickle your brain ventricles. It might seem that my mind is balanced, but I thank God that I'm born with this talent. Me and my microphones connect like magnets. If there's a cure and my lyrics were a curse, you people gonna have it and put it in your purse. I wear my confidence all on my sleeves. My name is Chaos Keith, and this is what I believe.
This 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 I believe.